You're about to see a program by Cornel West, theologian at Princeton, now a professor at Harvard. Cornel West is in the tradition of Eugene Debs, Norman Thomas, and Michael Harrington, in that black prophetic tradition of Martin Luther King. Cornel West is the honorary chair of the Democratic Socialist of America. He's put out a variety of books. His most famous is the recent Race Matters. But a variety of other books are just as thoughtful and provocative. Keeping Faith, one, Prophetic Thought in Postmodern Times, and Prophetic Reflections. What you're going to see is Cornel West here reflecting on the future of this country, what it's capable of, his hopes and dreams for the future of the United States. I hope you enjoy it.
So appropriate that we take this kind of time to reflect on Brother Irving Howe. Just two conferences ago in Baltimore, I remember we had a session where he put forward his critique, powerful critique of DSA in a supportive manner. I want to say a few words about Irving before I move into the dialogue, because I think he's one who has not only inspired me, but certainly inspired many of us, and his example bears on where we are and where we're going. The first thing I wanted to say about Irving Howe was the fact that he had such intellectual discipline. And this is very important, that he believed that democratic socialists ought to take the life of the mind with utter seriousness, which meant that he would not put up with any kind of anti-intellectualism in the socialist movement or a fetishizing of action and praxis that did not take seriously rigorous reflection about what one's up against. Friend, he was an exemplary public intellectual in that regard. And he went much further. He did something very few in public intellectuals do these days, namely he wrote clearly. He had a wonderful way with words. Three of my favorite texts of Irving's was Politics in the Novel, alluded to earlier, in which one can just simply read passages for lucid prose. It's unbelievable. The little book on Trotsky and Modern Masters series as well, not only a history of the socialist movement, written so clearly with such verve. And then this little book, The American Newness, the Massey Lectures at Harvard that he gave on Emerson, reflecting on American radicalism in light of his own trajectory. Intellectual discipline. Second is personal style. Irving was an endemic skeptic. Now, it was peppered with a little wit all the time. But the skepticism was always there. Not a paralyzing skepticism, not an impotent, ironic consciousness, but a skepticism that always acknowledged where the blindnesses would be in any particular project, looking at the assumptions and presuppositions of any project and so forth. And I believe in the doses of skepticism, empowering forms of skepticism, because it means it creates a certain kind of self-critical disposition that precludes self-righteousness. And of course, we know that there's been heavy doses of self-righteousness on the left, given our history of being relatively marginalized. Marginal folk tend to want to hold on to self-righteousness when you don't have too much power. At least my view is right. But that's serious. Of course, Irving knew that such self-righteousness would get in the way of the kind of democratic spirit that was requisite for any organization that would prefigure a radical democratic society. Last but not least about Irving was the deep political conviction. He rarely talked about the depths of the moral indignation that he had against injustice and social misery, but it was always in his writings. I recall even at the meetings at the editorial board, dissent was always in his voice, in his comments. And to think that here's someone who would turn down Harvard and a whole host of other institutions to stay in New York to run a journal 40 years now, next year. 40th anniversary will be at Windmark in a few months. 40 years to keep that institution going, to edit that institution when he could have been hiding behind Ivy League walls. It's quite rare among public intellectuals. And it leads us directly, I think, to where we are now, because I think we have to acknowledge, and in some way, celebrated only for a moment, the fact that we're still here. It was many who said in March of 1982 that DSA would never make it through the first decade. Never make it through the Ice Age. When those powerful conservative elites organized and solidified and began to shape this society in their image and in light of their own interests, DSA did survive. Brother Michael died in 1989. Many people said DSA would not survive. We are still here, growing, to some degree hollowed out, with our locals not as strong, but growing with new energy, building on the best visions and analyses of the past, but recognizing that we're in a very, very unique and distinctive moment in the history of this country. And that's something that I think we ought to, at least momentarily, pat ourselves on the back. Sometimes I wondered whether we'd still be here. I've always thought that DSA was either a hope or a joke. There's one beacon of hope, so that we are the socialist leaven in the progressive loaf in American society. None of us have thought that somehow DSA would be the sole or exclusive vehicle for American radicalism. But we know that if we can be this socialist leaven that keeps alive an internationalist vision, that highlights the rule of capital, that it promotes the kind of strategies and tactics that we know must be multiracial and multicultural, precisely because capital is that powerful. And whatever movement we are in, whatever single issue, double issue, triple issue, or whatever, whatever, we still have the democratic socialist vision that accents this internationalist vision and this focus on class inequality and white supremacy and male supremacy and ecological abuse and homophobia. And then try to create an anti-corporate multiracial alliance. Still around. Still around. A hope. Not as so many thought a joke, did we? Simply were. Even if we were a joke, it was a fun joke because we had such a wonderful time together. But we're not a joke. We're not a joke. We're a small group sustaining our own subculture in which a certain kind of reflection and conversation takes place, in which radical democracy and democratic socialist sensibilities remain alive. A particular tradition, as it were, a tradition that we talked about last night. Where are we then in terms of Democratic Socialist Project and present? Well, one is that I think we are now moving on an international level where very much what Brother Allen talked about this morning is beyond just support work and engaging in a much higher level of international solidarity. In North America Incorporated, as Business Week puts it. Canada, USA, Mexico. I just talked with Brother Munoz, I think his name is, this morning. We're setting up some joint trips together in Mexico right around the elections in August. We'll be there in July. Brother Jose La Luz and others have talked about it. Be there in July. To serve as one who works alongside, not simply at a distance, engage in support work, but alongside, and vice versa with the Mexican comrades in the state. And of course, we've done this with the single-payer model in healthcare with our Canadian comrades. They worked alongside us in terms of International Solidarity. Our work with the SI, Socialist International, is very important because there's no way that we can talk about being democratic socialists and not have the kind of links with various parties and some pre-party formations around the world, even as we try to remain locally grounded. On the domestic front, I think it's very clear that this issue of cultural decay that we talked about last night is real. The issues of crime is something that we're going to have to hit head on. I think that in the next 18 months, crime is going to be the most salient issue that Americans will be reflecting on. Simply because it's out of control. I just attended a meeting in July, Washington, D.C. It's the first time they've had interagency gatherings in which we had Janet Reno, we had Richard Riley from the Department of Education, we had Donna Shalala from HGW, we had Henry Cisneros from UD, all together, and Lee Brown as well. This was in July, so you may have seen them on C-SPAN. Dealing with crime, and now they're thinking about a national committee to deal with the issue of crime, coming out of the White House itself, but linked to these interagencies. And the question becomes, how do we talk about crime in such a way that we accent our democratic socialist sensibilities? I won't go into that now. I touched on that briefly last night. But it has much to do with the decline in the quality of everyday life. It has much to do with the economic decline in the society. It has much to do with the sense of rage. I think one of the things that we must do as democratic socialists is stay in tune with the rage that people have. What keeps Rush Limbaugh on radio and television is that he taps into rage. White male rage especially, conservatively articulated. But the rage is real, and they can't wait to get it out, to scapegoat against the most vulnerable members of our society, working people and women and gays and lesbians and black folk. The rage is real. And we have been tuned with that rage, not simply to mirror it, but to be able to channel it. Of course, this is especially the case in black and brown communities. The distinctive feature that I fly and travel across this country and 200 or so times I speak during the year is rage. Flip side of sense of impotence, powerlessness. So how do we empower by channeling rage in constructive ways and then bring our own democratic socialist vision to bear to ensure that they don't fall into a narrow politics of identity or any progressive stance alongside a xenophobic sensibility. Sounds oxymoronic. Critique of white supremacy but put others down. Critique of male supremacy but hold at arm's length. Struggle against homophobia, on and on and on. We have a comprehensive vision. Related to this culture decay issue of crime and rage, of course, is the Clinton administration. I think they had a wonderful panel. Very much so. Why is the Clinton administration not taking seriously the investment stimulus element within their four-pronged strategy of dealing with welfare reform, dealing with the budget deficit, dealing with national service? He's got all four, and stimulus investment is taking the most beating. Budget deficit now center stage. National service, a gesture. Welfare reform, we shall see. They plan to hit it head on. Many of you may know that Clinton invited me to the White House back in September. We had a nice talk. It was there from 7:30 to 11:30. Fascinating. Chelsea read Race Matters, and Hillary read Race Matters, and Clinton wanted to find out who the chap was who wrote it. But it was very interesting, because one of the things he said was, when I see you on television, you always have this systemic critique talking about redistribution of wealth downward and bending consumption toward investment, and I need to be in contact with that, even though I know it's politically infeasible at the moment.
That surprises Clinton.
And I told him quite explicitly, I said, yes, I do the best I can to tell him the truth about the situation as I see it. That's a prophetic role. You specialize in having political savvy to get elected. And what I try to do is to ensure that in telling the truth as I understand it, keeping track of the social misery and socially induced forms of suffering, that we might be able to create some spaces so that you can maneuver more broadly and accent the prophetic element within your own neoliberal project. That's exactly what I think. And of course, you heard me say. One of the honorary chairs. And then we are out there trying to organize and mobilize, and we can bring the kind of half of the kind of pressure that Ross Perot and others bring. You might be able to pass not simply a stimulus bill of $16 billion, but the 30 that you promised, or maybe the 60 that we wanted. And not just that, we talked about minimum wage. How upset I was that they had put that on the back burner. And the rice went there. God bless him. And he was upset as well. But he had a chance to channel his own critique through me to Clinton. Yeah, but I said, that's a good point. I said, that's your point, right? I said, I have a good point. That's your point, you ever call. And I talked about direct taxation on wealth. I talked about profit sharing at the workplace, and so forth and so on. I mean, Clinton listens. I mean, he is one who's quite attuned to what is possible at the moment, if you can imagine. What was amazing to me was, though, his openness to talk. I figured about 9 o'clock I had to get back to the hotel because I had things to do. I didn't realize, does he have a job? Went on and went to sleep. He's still going. God, head of the last empire in the 20th century, got all this kind of time. Quite interesting. He likes to talk. But I'm going to sustain him next 2 days. He wrote a very kind letter. I want to stay in contact and so forth and so on. Of course, I'm under no illusions. I know that this could be his subject come and go. He also knows I'm a good friend of Bill Bradley. And Bill Bradley's a possible contender. So we'll be working on a friend in that regard. But I say this not to make myself center stage, but to say how, in fact, we can define ourselves in relation not to an individual, but a set of policies and programs. And I think this particular panel that we heard before summed it up so well. I mean, I think Jack's remarks, as well as the others, hit it on the head in terms of both certain levels of efficiency, certain blindnesses, but also certain possibilities. Last point, I'll sit down, and that is on a personal level, I've been struggling with the relationship between DSA and the New Party. The New Party's been coming at me strong, Joel Rogers and Sandy Pope and others. The New Party, of course, aspiring toward a high level of organization, trying in fact to create a third way. We had a wonderful discussion this morning with the National Political Committee about this. And I'm convinced that DSA is not only the left organization in the country, but there will be no serious talk about parties that does not in some way come to terms with our efforts to create social movements, our efforts to bond and link the variety of different left liberal forms of political activity. And yet we also know that we can't make party formation a fetish to jump out without a mass base. And at the same time, as Julie Swartz has put in his resolution, be preoccupied with parties with candidates in a Democratic Party. No matter how much charisma they may have or what presence they may have at the moment, we don't have links to grassroots organization. So we're trying to walk a very slippery tightrope, and we've been trying to walk that for a while. And it's very important that we don't have the image of simply being people within the Democratic Party who give lip service to democratic socialist sensibility, but really are party functionaries. No, we don't. Democratic Party out progressive space, which is waning in that party, is the only place to go, oftentimes at a national level. On a local level, we look for much more progressive space, progressive candidates, regional level as well. But we want to ensure that we don't in any way have the image of being the parasites on or appendages of a Democratic Party, which itself, as we know, is a very deep crisis. If Clinton loses in 1996, it is a completely different political terrain in this country. The Democratic Party itself may split or realignment, and we have to be ready for that. So in conclusion, I'll say that it's just so good to know that that we're still going, we're growing, we're financially sound, which is alien years for those of us who were here when the DSA was founded, and that the legacy of Harrington especially, but Howe as well, is still very, very much alive. Thank you all so much.
Party, and is there going to be a realignment? It strikes me that the past few weeks that we may be reaching some kind of watershed over NAFTA. I mean, this realignment may be taking place as we're sitting here, and particularly the labor movement, maybe finally deciding something. What do you think about what's happening now, and is this realignment possibly going to happen sooner than we thought?
That's a good question. It all depends on how deep these cleavages actually cut in regard to NAFTA. We know the conflict is real now. We've got health care coming up. And another realignment can easily occur right after NAFTA in this regard. So it depends on how deep they cut. My hunch is that even given the fierceness of NAFTA at the moment, that it doesn't cut deep enough for a fundamental realignment. I think the realignment would more than likely come after the election. There you have hopes and aspirations that are either shattered or to some degree fulfilled. NAFTA, I think, might be stirrings of it, but the conflict doesn't cut deep enough for the kind of realignment that I have in mind. But a Clinton defeat in 96 would certainly throw the Democratic Party, not just in disarray, but in very deep crisis. I would think it's one of the deepest crises the Democratic Party has ever faced. Now, I'm not arguing that his defeat would be necessarily a good thing. This is just a descriptive claim that I'm putting forward. Yeah.
I have a question about the impact of the Kaiser correspondence and also the recent trends in the African American left. The debate that you've been in about ethnocentricity and the claim that your books have had recently. How those two things impact on the possibility of rebuilding a multicultural left and ESA's outreach into those communities?
Yeah, that's a good question, actually. Because paradoxically, there's two things going on. Did you hear the question?
No.
Yeah, the question had to do with the impact of the varieties of Afrocentrism that are running quite, that are afoot in the black community, in the black intellectual community, La Fersante and others. And the Committee of Correspondence that comes out of the older New Left, the old Communist parties and so forth, that begin to shed their own red skins and begin to rethink what it means to be a socialist and begins to sound very much more and more like democratic socialism that we've been promoting for decades. And those are two very important points. One is that there's a certain paradoxical situation, I think, in the black community. On the one hand, you have escalating black national sensibility, which is quite suspicious of any multiracial alliance. And especially among young people. In my bad debates, with Sister Soldier and others. who simply have given up on the idea of multiracial alliance. And I see this in black colleges and black enclaves and PWIs, predominantly white institutions, and so forth. And that's disheartening. It's disheartening, you know. And I'm usually cast as someone who represents King's legacy as outdated, antiquated, and played out. Still calling for holding hands across the racial chasm. That's old. You see, we black nationalists. We had some of that after the session last night. I got nice dialogue with some black nationalists, brother. We're coming back to Los Angeles to be in dialogue with them. But on the other hand, there are those who are acknowledging that agreeing with black nationalist politics leads to a cul-de-sac in a day. And the question is, where will they go after they reach that point in which, boom, hit a roadblock? And one of the reasons why they hit roadblocks over two issues, gender, class. Homophobia, not so much. That's another protracted struggle in the black community that I'm also engaged in. But that's going to take much longer, not because our intensity is less about that issue, but because the social conservatism in relation to that issue is that deeply entrenched in the black community. But gender and class, black nationalists have to come to terms. Once they begin to come to terms with that, then they become much open to the kind of democratic socialist politics that we represent. And the Committee of Correspondents play a very important role in this regard, because they tend to have a bit more legitimacy among certain black nationalist groups coming out of the old communist left than democratic socialists do, as perceived by black nationalists. Now, myself, I'm able to get away with a lot because of my black church connections. So the black nationalists see me as someone who is, you know, rooted in the black community to the degree to which he's preaching in a variety of different pulpits in black communities 40 weeks out of 52, and therefore you can't claim that this democratic socialist who associates with DSA doesn't have any links to the black community. The black church comes in to help me out, to put it crudely, in that regard. But that's very important, actually. So that what happens is that when you have a gathering, you're able then to bring in folk from an organic black institution, just like we had some last night from the black church, along with secular brothers and sisters of all colors, along with a slice of black nationalists who like to claim that they have the authentic organic ideology that comes out of black communities.